My research is really on two different topics. One is phytoplasmas, and the other one is on aphids. But in terms of the scope of what I'm interested in, it doesn't make a difference between the two projects, because what I really want to know is how virulence proteins modulate plant processes so that they become more susceptible or more resistant to insects. All right, so I decided that today I will talk a bit more about the phytoplasma project. And this is really what we're looking at. This is a leaf-like flower. This has normally this flower has the white petals, and it's like a real flower. But phytoplasma is changing it into leaf-like flowers. And phytoplasma is actually transmitted by this insect called a leafhopper. It's like related to an aphid. And there's a sap-sucking insect. And this particular insect can acquire the phytoplasma and move it to other plants, like transmit it to other plants. So this phytoplasma is actually modulating both the plant host, also the insect host. And that's what we're interested in, to see how phytoplasma might do that. This is a project that started when Akiko Sujio was in the lab. And she's now a project leader at INRA-RAN, working on aphids, P-aphid interaction with legumes. Has continued by Alison McLean, as postdoc in the lab. It's her last week this week, unfortunately. Sigmund Zorlowskis, a PhD, has also been working on this project. We have a few collaborators, which are both in Wageningen, but also other collaborators. So, really, as I said, it's the website, it's my website. And we work on aphids and on phytoplasmas. And we are interested in molecular plant microbe insect interactions. And that's including effectors from phytoplasma, as well as effectors from aphids and whiteflies. Today, if you want to learn more about both projects, please visit the website, and I can answer any question if you email me. But for today, I've decided I will talk about the phytoplasma. Now, phytoplasmas modulate their environment. And this is really a few examples. Phytoplasmas are very important pathogens of carrots, lettuce, and all vegetables. Also in Europe and in the US and everywhere else, really. They also cause disease in trees, like in fruit trees, like blackberry and raspberry, as you may be more familiar with. Like lime. Lime, which is broom phytoplasma, is now a huge problem in the lime industry in Oman, for example, and in Iran. This phytoplasma is destroying the entire lime industry there. And we work with them to figure out what's going on. And there's also other ones like pear decline and apple perforation, which are actually quite significant issues in Germany and in Europe in general. And they're quarantine organisms. So in the US or elsewhere in the world, they're not occurring yet. So they are only now in Europe. And they cannot export some products because of the phytoplasma. What I want to show here is that phytoplasma can actually also is very prevalent in wild plants, in weeds everywhere. And this is an infected coneflower. And what I would like you to see is that this is the back is a healthy coneflower, has normal flowers. And the front, it's an affected one. And you can see it has all leaf-like tissues sprouting out of the leaf-like tissue, or the flower-like tissues. All right? And here you can see it a bit better. Now you know that perhaps that poinsettias are actually infected with phytoplasma on the right. And these are called stunting agents. And when you buy a poinsettia in the store, you actually buy the right one. They're all infected with phytoplasmas because they look more bushier and prettier than the non-infected one. So by crafting, the phytoplasma is maintained inside the poinsettias, and this is you can buy in the store. So phytoplasmas, what are they? Phytoplasmas are bacteria. And these are the phytoplasmas you can see here. They're kind of small bacteria, like 500 nanometers in diameter. And they obligate, so we can't culture them in artificial medium outside the host. So these are inside the cytoplasm of the host. And see, they are surrounded by a single cell membrane, and they relate to gram-positive bacteria. However, they do not have an outer cell wall. So the phytoplasmas, the spiroplasmas, and the mycoplasmas all have lost their outer cell wall. And so the mycoplasmas are only really surrounded by a cell membrane, a single cell membrane, unlike gram-negative bacteria that have two cell membranes. And phytoplasmas have a unique life cycle that actually involves two different hosts. It's the insect host and the plant host. And that's actually very quite unique. Most bacteria, as you may know, are very specialized to plants or to insects or to other animals. All right, so there's hardly any bacteria that can actually move back and forth between an animal host and a plant host. But this bacteria does this. So it infects the insect. It really replicates inside the insect. It moves around the insect, around the gut and the salivary glands, and also the nerve system, and it takes over the insect. But also the plant, it can replicate inside the plant. And what happens is that this insect is feeding from the phloem of the plant. It acquires the phytoplasma, and then the phytoplasma goes from the gut into the hemolymph. And it takes about 10 days before the entire insect is infected. And the salivary glands also get infected. And when the insect feeds, it will then transmit the phytoplasma to the plant. Now, many phytoplasmas are transmitted by leaf hoppers, but others are transmitted by plant hoppers. And like pear decline, apple perforation phytoplasmas are transmitted by psyllids. And social psyllids that are quite common here in Britain. So these are we're working mostly on hemipteran insects, and what they have in common is the stinging mouthparts, like stylets, that reach to reach to the phloem. But some also feed from the xylem, and others feed from the mesophyll. But most of what we study is that they feed from the phloem, and they're all hemipterans over here. And I just want to point out, and maybe some of you know this, but maybe you don't, so I'll point it out anyway, is that these insects, the hemipterans, are very distantly related to the like moths and bees and mosquitoes, for example. 320 million years ago, they have diverged. And humans are only 70 million years ago removed from a mouse. You see, so they're quite diverse. And for this reason, it's maybe not so likely that we can actually use a fruit fly or Drosophila as a model system to actually study aphids or leaf hoppers for that matter. So what we're doing is we are trying to create genetic resources for aphids, also leaf hoppers and white flies, so that we can actually do some research on these organisms unrelated to what's known of Drosophila. Now, these are the phytoplasms. Phytoplasmas are quite diverse, a lot of different phytoplasms described worldwide. But they actually separate into three different clusters. And in this cluster number two, that's where the apple perforation pear decline occur, which is also detected in Britain. And then European strong food yellows is also here. But we are really investigating these phytoplasmas, and these also involve stulber, which are potato and tomato pathogens, grapevine pathogens, and the Aspergillus phytoplasmas, which are very common in all kinds of vegetables, including carrots and lettuces and oilseed rape, for example. And then there's this group three, which has like very, very diverse phytoplasmas, and these include also grapevine phytoplasmas, but the most famous one is actually coconut lethal yellows. And coconut lethal yellows is really a problem in a lot of coconuts in Africa, in Asia, and now also in Mexico and the US. And we are investigating Aspergillus witch's broom. It's this one, it's called Aspergillus witch's broom. And this particular phytoplasm is inducing witch's broom, like apple perforation does in apple. We're looking at these pathogens, especially this one, because this has a very broad host range. It infects like 400 different plant species in 50 different families. And it's transmitted by a polyphagous insect. And whereas other phytoplasmas are often specialized, they often transmit it to apple or pear, and they do not have a broad host range. What we like about Osteales witch's broom, that does also infect Arabidopsis. And because it infects Arabidopsis, we can actually look at the mechanism by which the phytoplasm modulates plant species, and also how it modulates plant-insect interaction. So phytoplasma, this particular Osteales witch's broom, is inducing witch's broom like this in Arabidopsis as well. This is a normal plant, and when it's infected, it's becoming stunted, but then also it has many, many different branches, as you can see, and we refer to it as witch's broom, and this is a very common symptom in all phytoplasmas, including pear decline and apple perforation and Lyme witch's broom. And what this phytoplasm is also doing is inducing leafy flowers, leaf-like flowers. So here you have normal-looking Arabidopsis flowers with white petals. But when it's infected, you get these leaf-like flowers. And what happens is that normally flowers are determinate, right? So you don't get another structure coming out of it, except for example the seed capsule, of course. But that's it. It doesn't grow other vegetative tissues out of the flower. But in an infected plant, you can see that other tissues are coming out of the flower. So you get the flower-in-flower phenotype, and this plant grows forever. it has a stem coming out of a stem, out of a flower, out of a stem, and so forth. So it's having this witch's broom phenotype because of it. Another phenotype is related to the insect factor. You can see the insect is laying eggs in this case. It's a leafhopper that lays eggs, and these eggs hatch and then they into nymphs, like here. And what we found is that infected plants are more susceptible to the leafhopper. You see here that is a healthy healthy Arabidopsis plant in this case, but there's also other plant species we found this with. And then when it's infected, this leafhopper can produce 60% more progeny on this plant species. It actually lays more eggs. So you found more eggs as well as more nymphs on infected plant species. We are interested to see how this phytoplasm is doing this. What's happening to the plant host? And how does it make the witch's broom? How does it make leaf-like flowers? And how does it actually help the insect propagate? That's what we have investigated. And our hypothesis is really that the phytoplasm is producing virulence proteins. So it's excreting virulence proteins and into the plant cell or in the insect cell. And then these virulence proteins are modulating the plant host or the insect host, all right? So what are these question marks? That's our question. And just to back up the hypothesis here, so basically this is a phytoplasma. And phytoplasma are intracellular. They're inside the cytoplasm of a plant cell. It's not like Pseudomonas, Santimonas. They're outside. They have a type 3 secretion system, and then they put the virulence proteins inside the plant by different secretion systems. In this case, what happens, the phytoplasma is already inside the cell because it's there. The leafhopper has inoculated the cell with the phytoplasma. So this is inside the cell. And all it needs is a sec-dependent pathway, a sec-dependent secretion system, to secrete the proteins inside the plant cell. And what these proteins have is a signal peptide. It's a signal peptide on the N-terminus of the protein. And then when they secrete it, the N-terminus is cleaved off, and the mature protein without the signal peptide is secreted. Okay, and because of this characteristics, we can actually sequence the genome of the phytoplasma and look for proteins that have a signal peptide and are likely to be secreted. Okay, so that's what we have done. So we mined, so we sequenced the genome already a while ago. It was published in 2006, and we looked for candidate effectors. These are secreted proteins. All right. So in so we have we found 56 secreted phytoplasma proteins. We call them SEPs. Right. And what we did is we wanted to know what the phenotypes are. Right. So we expressed these effector genes in Arabidopsis. And then we looked for Arabidopsis developmental phenotypes or for changes in leafhopper resistance. So we have we could just generate lots of transgenic plants. But this is to show what really happens. So this is a leafhopper. The leafhopper is inoculating the phytoplasma inside the sieve elements of the phloem. And then these phytoplasma secrete effectors. Furans proteins, and these furans proteins can stay in the phloem, but they can also move from cell to cell. And we found that actually these effectors are moving throughout the plant. They leave the phloem, they unload from the phloem, and they move from cell to cell. But the phytoplasma stays inside the phloem. So we have found 56 effectors. Or candidate effectors in the genome of the phytoplasma, and we transformed one by one inside the Arabidopsis, and then we did phenotyping. So for each line, we analyzed 10 plants to see if we could see any developmental phenotypes, and we screened 48 so far. Now, what came out of this screen is this: we have two effectors. We call SEP11, so SEP11 and SEP54, that can change development of the plant. And also SEP11 and SEP54, as I will show you later, can actually make the plant more susceptible to insect factors. These are furans proteins that are made by the phytoplasma, right? So they inside the plant cell, the phytoplasma secretes these effectors inside the plant cell, and what happens is that they induce these phenotypes. I'm going to say a bit more about SEP11. So SEP11 is a protein when we overexpress it in Arabidopsis. The Arabidopsis plant changes into a kale-like organ, so that becomes kale. You can see that here. So they have kale-like leaves. And what also happens, these plants are producing more stems. So you get proliferation of the Arabidopsis stems. And you can see that the protein is very highly expressed inside those plants. And we wanted to find out what is SEP11 doing. And we did a yeast to hybrid screen. So this is a yeast to hybrid screen is to figure out what SEP11 interacts with in the plant. And we found that this particular protein is interacting with a very conserved group of transcription factors called TCPs. And TCPs are involved in promoting cell proliferation as well as promoting leaf maturation and senescence. And SEP11 does interact with TCPs of the class 2 subfamily that promote leaf maturation and senescence. And basically what we found is that SEP11 destabilizes all of these transcription factors. It destabilizes transcription factors that induce maturation and senescence. So actually the plant is not inducing senescence anymore. Okay, so and this is actually very this is like the microRNAs. These are also microRNAs characterized that negatively regulate those transcription factors called microRNA 319A and 3TCP. If you make plants, make transgenic plants that overexpress these microRNAs, you get kale-like leaves, which actually look very similar to our SEP11 transcripted overexpression lines. Now, while we were investigating this, it was found that the TCPs actually positively regulate jasmonate acid synthesis. And this is a paper that was published at about the same time, and they're investigating our CEP11 protein, so we were very lucky. Basically what they found is that in microRNA overexpression lines that knock down the TCPs, also the LOX2 expression is down. And LOX2 is a very important hormone. It's the first gene, actually, that makes jasminate. It's involved in the synthesis pathway of jasminate. And jasminate, as you know, is a very important hormone in wounding, but also defense in insect attack. So it's involved in mediating plant defenses. And we found that when we knock down LOX2 in Arabidopsis, see here is LOX2 knocked down. It's an Arabidopsis plant where LOX2 is knocked down. Then the leafhoppers do much better. So they produce more eggs on the LOX2 overexpression knockdown lines. We did a bit more work on this. So we found that indeed, if you overexpress CEP11 in the Arabidopsis lines, you do get less LOX2 mate, or less LOX2 overexpression in the Arabidopsis. So these plants produce less JA. And this is to show that it also happens with JA production. So this is a 35S CEP11 line with a stippled line. And this is a normal wild type COL0 line. And if you wound it, then you get jasminate production. But in the presence of CEP11, you can see there is less jasminate being made when you wound the plant. This also happens in an infected plant. So these are infected plants. And in young leaves, when you wound it, you get a production of jasminate in the healthy lines. But in a phytoplasma-infected plant, you get less jasminate being made in young leaves. And at last, we found that in a similar assay, so these are CEP11 overexpression lines. When we put the insects on, they lay more eggs on the CEP11 lines compared to the wild-type plants. So this is what we found happened. So this is for the CEP11 protein, a bit of a summary of what we found. Phytoplasmas are in the phloem, in the sieve elements. They secrete the effector proteins inside the sieve cells. These effector proteins move from cell to cell, and we know that they locate to the nuclei outside the phloem cells. They interact with TCPs, and they degrade them. Because TCPO positively regulate LOX2, you get less LOX2 being made, therefore less jasminate being made, and more egg laying. And this is actually important because, you know, when the eggs hatch, these insects start feeding right away, right? And when they start feeding, they acquire the phytoplasma. So here it goes, these are nymphs, and they acquire the phytoplasma. And when these nymphs become adults, they move around. So they spread the phytoplasma around in the field. So we think that CEP11 has a very profound effect on the fitness of the phytoplasma through helping the insect factor to disperse the phytoplasma. Make sense? So, and this was really, we have not done any field work, but luckily colleagues in Germany did some field work for us. Well, not in collaboration with them, but was a separate paper by Ian Baldwin's group. And they did a very interesting experiment. What they did is they did this field test in Utah. And this is what they did. So they had a big planting of different plants here, Nicotiana attenuata plants. And these Nicotiana attenuata plants were all wild type, or they had some mutants in there. And this mutant, this LOX3 mutant, is similar to the LOX2 of Arabidopsis. Okay, so these plants make less jasminate. And what they did is they mowed the alfalfa field. So they mowed it. And then the leafhoppers moved from here, to the plantation. And then they looked how many leafhoppers are on which plants. And what happens is that on the LOX3 plant, as you can see here, These are very attractive to the leafhoppers. And these plants, these make less jasminate. So apparently somehow the leafhopper sense these plants that make less jasminate. And if the phytoplasma is indeed they found that makes less jasminate, so maybe the phytoplasma, in fact, the plants are more attractive to the leafhoppers, which then they can use to for the phytoplasma to spread around the leafhoppers. So then I'm going to talk a little bit more about SEP54 as well. And SEP54 is inducing leaf-like flowers. Now, SEP54, when you overexpress it inside the plant, what you get is a leafy flower. And this is a normal flower, healthy wild-type flower. And this particular plant, when infected or when expressing the SEP54, what you see is stems coming out of the leaf-like flower. So it's a stem and flower-in-flower phenotype. And also the petals remain green. Like SEP11, what we did is we did a yeast hybrid screen to figure out what SEP54 interacts with in the plant. And we found that SEP54 interacts with matchbox transcription factors. Now you may know that matchbox transcription factors are very important for the flowering and floral organ development. This is how it works, and this is a kind of ABC pattern, ABC development pattern, in which different matchbox transcription factors play a role in the formation of the sepal, the petal, the stamen, and the carpel. And depending on the combination of matchbox transcription factors, you get one versus the other organ. And SEP54 interacts with AP1 and SEPALLATA 3. Two of the many transcription factors, matchbox transcription factors. This is AP1, and there's an AP1 mutant that we analyzed. And this is here you can see this is an AP1 mutant, and you can see that has also leaf-like flowers, like the GFP SEP54 overexpression line. Okay, a little bit different, but also there are some similarities. And we did the same study as the SEP11. Mm-hmm. What we found, if we express SEP54 with a control or the matchbox transcription factor in the Nicotiana menthiana leaf, you can see that in the presence of SEP54, and the matchbox transcription factor, the matchbox transcription factor disappears. There is no matchbox transcription factor anymore. Whereas in the control, you can see matchbox transcription factor. So suggesting that the SEP54 is degrading the matchbox transcription factor. And this is what happens. SEP54 interacts with matchbox transcription factor. Something happens, you get degradation of the matchbox transcription factor, and you get leaf-like flowers. We found that probably in the plant cell, there's a 26S proteasome that's involved. Because if we use an inhibitor of the 26S proteasome, which is called epoxamycin, then you do not get degradation anymore. And you can see that here. This is with epoxamycin. This is epoxamycin in here. And when epoxamycin is present, the matchbox transcription factor does not disappear. See? So that means that the 26S proteasome is involved. Now, in the yeast hybrid screen, we also found another protein called the RAT23. And this RAT23 is an, I focus a bit on that. This is a protein that brings proteins to the 26S proteasome. Here you can see that. This is RAT23. And RAT23 binds targets. And when these targets then brought to the proteasome, and these targets then degraded by the proteasome, but RAT23 itself is not. and binds other targets and brings them to the protease. So, all right. So that's what we found, that Rat23 is it binds to CEP54, and so we figured that maybe it's bringing the CEP54 and the MetSpox transcription factors to the proteasome for degradation. Arabidopsis does have four different Rat23 homologs, and it's Rat20A, B, C, and D. And we found that phytoplasma CEP54 is binding to Rat23 C and D, but not A and B. So there's no binding here, but there is binding to C and D. So only two out of the four Rat23 proteins interact with CEP54. And I see that here as well. You can here see it's called zero. And this is a GFP CEP54 plant. We pull down CEP54 from the plant. And when we do that, we detect in indeed Rat23 C and D, but we do not detect it in a mutant of C and D. See, this is a mutant, Arabidopsis mutant. We did the same pull down, and then we cannot see the Rat23 proteins anymore. It's also suggesting that the CEP54 interact with these two proteins in planta. And then we work with we had a paper that we discovered from another group, and they have actually made Rat23 mutants. So it's an Arabidopsis, it's Rat23 A, B, C, and D mutants, and we introduced the CEP54 protein in these mutants. And you can see here that when the CEP54 is in the A and the B background, you get leaf-like flowers. But when it's in the C and D background, you get a little bit of leaf-like flowers, but much less than the A and B background. And we also then generated double mutants. See this AC, AD, BC, CD, and DB. These are all double mutants in the Rat23. And when the two mutants, C and D, are combined, and CEP54 is in there, then you get normal flowers. So that means that Rat23 is a susceptibility factor for the effector. We also did this with infection. So this is a Rat23 BD plant, and we infected it. And because this one has C that interacts with CEP54, you can still leave like flowers. But this one doesn't have C. C is mutated in this particular plant. And when you infect this plant with the phytoplasma, you get normal flowers. Okay. So this is what we found, is that CEP54 interacted with MetSpox transcription factors. And Rat23. The Rat23 is likely to bring this complex to the 26S proteasome, leading to degradation of the MetSpox transcription factors in leaf-like flowers. And this is therefore the target of the effector, and that is the helper of the effector. And I think this is really important to realize this, because, you know, the CEPs, all the MetSpox transcription factors and the Rat23s are conserved in most flowering plant species. They're conserved in all, in fact, plant species. And this is good because Osteosvitis broom infects Arabidopsis and more than 100 plant species of diverse families. Right? So by going after something conserved, it can actually modulate many different plant species, not only Arabidopsis. And the whole ABC pattern of flower development is conserved also. So these are the ABC pattern, and it's very similar in Antirrhinum, for example, and in Arabidopsis. They're very in divergent plant species. You get exactly the same pattern of development that results in flower development. And these phytoplasmas have found a very nice target to go after. So just to show you that this particular phytoplasma that we're working with is also inducing leafy flowers in other plant species when they're infected. So this is periwinkle, and this is the periwinkle that has normal flowers, like white petals. But when infected with the phytoplasma, these flowers become leaf-like. And this is petunia. And petunia also, when infected with the phytoplasm, you get leaf-like flowers. So Ostiella phytoplasma infects many plant species, and it's also transmitted by a polyphagous insect vector. And this is the insect vector. This is a leafhopper, Microscalis graniatus. And you can see that this leafhopper likes to feed from green tissues, and also likes to lay eggs on green tissues. So maybe the leaf-like flowers are very beneficial for the insect vector. And so we tested this. In a choice test, you can see here what we have is a cage. And on the left side we have a plant, and on the right side a plant. And we introduced different plants, ones with leaf-like flowers, ones without leaf-like flowers, to see what the insects are preferring. And the first test was with the red 23 plants. So these are infected red 23 plants. And the red 23 BD has leaf-like flowers. But the red 20 PCD does not have leaf-like flowers. And you can see that the phytoplasma of the leafhopper is really preferring the ones with the leaf-like flowers. And when the plants are not infected, so these both have normal flowers, right, because they're not infected, then the leafhopper doesn't make a choice. So it's really the leaf-like flowers that look like attracting the insect. And also, these are the transgenic plants, the SEP54 transgenic plants. These have leaf-like flowers, and these ones do not have leaf-like flowers. And again, you can see that the insect prefers the ones with leaf-like flowers. Now, this effector is conserved among very many different phytoplasmas. And there's just a few here. This is from different phytoplasmas. Peanut witch's broom here, or onion yellows, Maryland Oster yellows. So these are different phytoplasmas, and you can see there is conservation. But they do induce slightly different symptoms, as you can see here. So here is a phytoplasma SEP54 protein that makes this flower phenotype, so get these very long stems. But peanut witch's broom SEP54, however, is making a cauliflower symptom. And that one looks like an AP1 cauliflower double mutant, and cauliflower is also a matchbox transcription factor. So what we think is that depending on the phytoplasma, they may target slightly different matchbox transcription factors, and nonetheless they go after matchbox transcription factors. So then we also looked at what happens in the insect vector. So they move back and forth from the plant to the insect, right? So we argue that, okay, there must be different effectors going up and down depending on where it is. And so here we did an expression analysis of 56 effectors that we characterized first. So here you can see all these effectors and whether or not they expressed in the plant or whether they expressed in the insect vector. And it seems that around 2/3 of the effectors are expressed in the plant, whereas 1/3 of the effectors are expressed in the insect. And you can see that the ones we study, SEP11 and SEP54, are the ones that are actually infecting or upregulating the plant, which is consistent with our finding that they interfere with plant development. And we have another one that we think is really interesting and we're going after at the moment, and it's called SEP41. And for this I need to explain a bit of entomology here, at least for our system, and that's we have a generalist, right? This particular leafhopper is transmitting the Ostiella's witch's broom to many different plant species, so it can infect many different plant species. But we also have another insect factor, which is a specialist of maize. It only feeds on maize. It doesn't like Arabidopsis. When you put it on Arabidopsis, it dies, or any other dicot plant for that matter. It doesn't like these plants. And this particular leafhopper is actually a very important transmitter of another phytoplasma called maize bushy stunt phytoplasma. We already knew that when plants like Arabidopsis infected with the phytoplasma, then these plants become more susceptible to the Dalbulus maidus. So these plants become hosts for Dalbulus maidus. So they move from maize to Arabidopsis, but only in infected plants. And you can see that here. It's a maize specialist that was put on the Arabidopsis plant. So here you can see it's healthy plants and infected plants, males and females of Dalbulus maidus. And these survive much longer than on infected plants than they do on healthy plants. And moreover, they start reproducing on the Arabidopsis plant. So this is very interesting because most leafhopper species are specialized. All insects for that matter. They are like 80% of the insect species or herbivores are specialized on one plant host. And you might wonder, therefore, that most plants are resistant to most insects, right? Think about it. But now this leaf of phytoplasma is made plant susceptible to the insect, to a maize specialist. So we're really interested to see what this effector is going after. And we found two effectors that seem to have play a role in this. So here you can see, on the y-axis you can see the number of eggs or nymphs on Arabidopsis plants of Dalbulus maidus, of this maize specialist. And on infected plant you see that they lay eggs, but on a healthy equals zero plant they don't lay eggs. But on these effectors, CEP19 and CEP41, transgenic lines, they start laying eggs. So now we're interested to figure out what CEP41 and 19 are going after in the plant. Because we know that maybe we found the Achilles heel of the plant and we could use it to make to kind of understand why how we can make a susceptible plant resistant to an insect. So this is what I told you. We have CEP11 and CEP11 and also CEP41, although we do not know exactly what it's going after yet. But both of them are inducing a great susceptibility of the plant to the leafhopper. And CEP54 is making leaf-like flowers, but also attracts the leafhoppers. This particular Osteales vicus broom is transmitted by a migratory insect called Oster leafhopper. And this leafhopper likes to overwinter in the south of the United States. And when in every spring, this leafhopper moves all the way up north to Canada. And phytoplasmas are found in oilseed rape in the north. And because of climate change, there is more phytoplasma infected oilseed rape earlier in the season. And it's becoming a problem in Canada. And we think that so you can see that they actually, this phytoplasma is infecting wheats, also camelina, which is actually very important for biofuel in the US, and also oilseed rape. And we think that maybe the more effectors that support leafhopper reproduction or attraction, the more likely it is that they move up north. So the effectors really help the migration. That's our hypothesis. And in Europe it's the same thing. Osteales is also a very common phytoplasma in Europe. And in recent years, they found phytoplasmas in carrots and also in bulbs in the Netherlands and in lettuces. Now we're working with a group in Poland. They have phytoplasma found very frequently in oilseed rape in Poland. These phytoplasmas are also transmitted by migratory insects, including Microstyles species, And they move north because one of the reasons is climate change and warmer winters. And there are other phytoplasma diseases as well, like maize redness disease in Serbia. And this is the infected oilseed rape that we also found in Poland. So I want to just end saying that phytoplasma convert plants into zombies that have no purpose on their own but propagate the parasite, because the plants cannot reproduce. They have leaves like flowers, they don't form seeds. All they appear to do is making sure that the parasite somehow gets to the insect vector. So with that, I'd like to acknowledge my lab. So the people in red are these people are just currently in my lab. And the people in red are working on the phytoplasma project. The people that are in black are working on the aphid project. And hopefully I can next time say something about aphids. former lab members. And these are like Akiko, for example. She did a lot of work in the initial stages on this project. And I'm really proud of is that many of them actually have now project leader positions all over the world as independent group leader. We had many different collaborators. I would like to really thank also Ian Bedford and Jordan and Kevin Head from the Joninus Center, who are we have in a quarantine insectary, and they keep all the insect populations there, including the phytoplasmas. So this is the funding, and thanks for your attention.